We're going to begin, okay? I think just about all here. My name's Lewis Blackwell. I'm the Strategy and Development Director of the Built Environment Trust, which is the organization that runs the building center, amongst other things. And it's been around quite a long time now, since 1931. It's a real pleasure to be helping this event go on this evening, because it's certainly an issue that over many years at various times we've touched on. And I'm really hoping we can help support some of the themes that I think can be touched on this evening. So I'll do a little housekeeping first of all. And that is, turn your phones off or turn it to silent. I think there's some information on there if you want to. Yeah, there's a hashtag and a what have you up there. So there's Wi-Fi if you want to get on that. But please turn to silent. Emergency exits. I should tell about that, shouldn't I? There's an emergency exit out there and out back out the way you came in. There's a drinks reception. That's a really important bit. Drinks reception afterwards. So you're all very welcome to go upstairs with the way you came in with the bar is, and there'll be drinks available. And that's kindly supported by Park Books, who are the publisher behind the book. So the book, Walter's Way and Segal Close, and a very long title it does have, which I'm sure the authors will take us through. Now, this is by Alice and Taran, and they're going to be talking in very short order all about it and taking us into information on the panel. But I just wanted to say a few words first of all, because from the Built Environment Trust perspective, you know, this idea of self-build is something which really does need such a lot more support. And you know, we have a government that is, in theory, all foreseeing a doubling of self-build and custom build by 2020. That was in the documents they published last year, this year, in a sort of manifesto. And I haven't really seen a lot going on to make me think they're going to get there anytime soon. And they've even actually also committed to the idea that we should see the model of what goes on in places like France, where 60% is categorized as self-build and custom build, 60% of all house building. Now, what an amazing change that would be. So, you know, we're dealing with something in the theme that we're celebrating in this book that is actually part of sort of social change, and certainly in change of how the built environment gets put together. And it has a government that is behind it. It has a sense of encouragement to local government, but things are not joining up yet. So I just love to work out how we're going to join this up and really start making that change. And there was a quote I found in when I was looking through the book, and in the words of Jon Broome's rather nice article, he wrote, "Policymakers and politicians often overlook the value of building communities and not just building houses." And of course, that is so much what happens here and what we're going to be celebrating tonight. So with that thought, I'd like to hand over to Alice.
Hello, good evening. Before we meet the panel, I just want to say a few words just to tell you a little bit of background about the book and why we did a book.
Reasons. And that is, we are videoing this evening. So there is a video being made of this evening, just in case you don't want to be seen. You have to hide yourself when you're asking a question. But if you are going to ask a question as well, please wait for this microphone to come to you so that we can capture your wonderful words as well.
Sure. Okay. Yeah, we've got a roving mic. We hope the evening's going to be very interactive and that you'll have lots of questions and comments. So I just want to tell you a little bit about why we did a book. I'm not an architect and neither am I a self-builder, but I am one of the residents of one of the self-build communities. I live in Walter's Way. My friend here, Taran, lives in Segal Close. I didn't know anything about Segal, and I never really thought much about architecture and design before moving in to this house, which was about 10 years ago. I could tell, you know, the house is a little bit unusual, which is, I think, why I chose it, why we liked it. A bit different to the normal average UK home, which is, you know, terraced brick-built home. The houses are quite sort of light. They're up on stilts. They're wooden. They've got big windows. And I thought, you know, this is something a bit different. And I was kind of then quite intrigued as to sort of, you know, what are they doing there? What are they doing in South London? Visitors, when they come, they often say that it just doesn't feel like Lewisham. It feels more like Scandinavia or Canada. A lot of people say it feels like a holiday home or some kind of lakeside retreat. So I did a little bit of research, found out about Walter Segal. I found out that he was born in Berlin. He's originally from Germany. born in 1907. He came to England in the 1930s, and in the 70s, he began this project with Lewisham Council that resulted in a scheme where ordinary people learnt the skills to build their own homes, which again, you know, very, very unusual, and the results are some very, what are considered now quite desirable homes. I think they weren't particularly sort of fashionable from the start, but now, in retrospect, compared to a lot of other houses, they are, you know, pretty good to live in. I found there were already two very good books on Walter Segal, one by John McKean, who is sitting over here, one also by Jon Broome, Learning from Segal and the Self-Build book. Had a look at those, and we thought then was I was talking to a lot of the self-builders and the residents of Walter's Way, and I kept hearing so many really interesting stories about what it was like back in the 70s and 80s, designing your own home with Walter Segal, and then actually spending 18 months or so in all weathers building your own home. I actually felt that there was enough information and enough stories there to actually make a book, just from the stories I was hearing just in my own street. That's why we decided to do a book. I met Taran, who is a brilliant photographer, and I'd like to just hand over to Taran for a few words now, if that's okay.
Yeah. Thanks. My name's Taran, and it's amazing to see so many of you guys here today. I think what I'd like to do is to start off with a list of thank yous, actually, to a number of people who have helped sort of contribute and support us in the production of our book. So I'm going to have to list this as quite a few people, but I do want to say these thank yous. I guess first and foremost to the residents and self-builders, some of them who are here today, from both streets, Walter's Way and Segal Close, for opening their doors and sort of talking to us about their individual experiences of living in a Segal home. So a big thanks to all of you guys. Special thanks also to Claire Palmer and Amy Selby for proofreading, and Ian White for technical information, Ben Summer for editing the book, and Helen Castle, Jackie Lofthouse for their editorial advice. Is Benji here, by the way? Benji. Yay! Big shout out to Benji as well, because Benji's amazing design expertise and really helped us put this whole project together. He's done an amazing job with the layout and the production of the book, so chapeau to you, sir. John Segal also, for sharing numerous stories of your father's life. Thank you very much. And Jon Broome, John McKean, obviously on our panel today, for generously giving time and written contributions and ongoing support to the project and bringing Segal and Self-Build to a wider audience again. Tom and Kareem, also thank you very much for joining the panel today. And our families as well, Paul, Emily, Celine, my wife, who's not here yet. She's looking after the two little ones, but she will be here at some point. But their patience throughout these long nights of pulling this all together has been immense. And not forgetting, obviously, the Building Centre for hosting tonight's event, and our publisher, Park Books as well, from Switzerland, I guess, in believing in the project that we'd sort of set out and producing the final book. So if you could just join me in giving these guys a round of applause. How did I come about, I guess, living in a Segal home? I guess similar to Alice, I'm not a self-builder. I'm okay at IKEA, putting things together, that's about it. But it was back in 2009, actually, when Celine and I first encountered a Segal home, and that was at an annual open house event on Walter's Way. And I guess we sort of instantly fell in love with the sort of uniqueness of the streets, the aesthetics of the timber-framed architecture, the sense of community, the layout of the houses, the light, the views, the list goes on. And then it was 2 years later, I guess, persistently looking for these kind of properties, which rarely come on the open market. And it was through the Modern House, some of you guys are here from there, that I finally came to live in one. So a thanks to Open House and Modern House as well for introducing me to Segal World. In terms of the format of the book, the idea of, I guess, making the book came through speaking to neighbours, as Alice touched on as well. But what we wanted to do was to sort of create a tangible record of the current residents and who and how they live in these Segal homes. So the format of the book kind of flows similar to an open house event where you'd meet the residents, enter their homes, and learn of their experiences as well. So the book will be on sale tonight after tonight's discussion, and we really hope you enjoy it. But I guess before we do that, has everyone seen a Segal home before? Put your hands up if you've seen a Segal home before. Great. Well, so that's good. But what I thought I'll do today to start things off was show you a 10-minute clip. It's a film produced by Architecture Foundation back in 2015 of Walter's Way. So some of you who haven't seen it, it'll be quite a good way and an introduction to what's to happen today. So let's get this up.
Anarchy is not a word you might normally associate with British council housing, but in 1979, the architect Walter Segal, who had grown up in an anarchic commune, began working on a remarkable experiment in self-build council housing. A small group of ordinary families were each given plots of land and allowed to build timber frame houses from scratch using an innovative set of principles designed by Segal. Today, what lessons can be learned about housing, community, and even anarchy from looking again at Walter's Way?
I think the street's quite unusual for a London street in that there's a real community feel here. The neighbours all know each other, the children all play together.
The doors are open during the summer months, and the kids are just going in and out of the houses. Once a year we have a street party, and that street party, maybe 300-400 people will be on the street. We'll have a stage at the bottom, we'll have live music, we'll have a bouncy castle, we'll have three barbecues on the go.
People pop in and say, yeah, can I borrow a cup of sugar or something like that? Or quite a lot of impromptu childcare and things like that.
We invited the council up here, and as soon as they walked down the street, the vibes that they felt, it's tangible, you can taste it.
Walter Segal was very clever in that he didn't just build a road, he seems to have actually created a community. And even now that the houses are mostly, in fact, entirely privately owned, and so that social housing element has gone, the community feel still remains. I think it's partly the shape of the street, the layout of the houses, and I think it might also be that the sort of people who are attracted to come and live here in some way share the ethos that Walter Segal brought those years ago when he originally designed the street.
You know, one could create self-sustaining communities of a similar nature. But in order to do that, you've got to establish a viable community to begin with.
It's no good just throwing up houses and saying, right, okay, this has cost so much and you buy your house and you move in. There's no connection between the people in that, and it's a new community. There's none at all. But if you've got people who are living and breathing the experience of what a self-build is, then you've created something.
Walter Segal lived in Switzerland when he was young.
Brought up in a continental tradition, he was a very intellectual, well-read, cultured person.
He had a kind of a very good eye and yeah, like cultured and educated background.
He was born in Berlin. His father was a fairly well-known artist called Arthur Segal.
He was modest, but he was visionary as well.
He came and he put a turbocharge up, you make you really want to get in and do it. And then after a while, it was like he'd come and he would talk for hours. So nothing good would happen. When Walter Segal would come, we'd try and keep going, but he would talk. He'd talk the hind legs off of a donkey.
Part of his ability, I think, to get things done was sheer obstinacy. I mean, he would lie if it needed. You know, he would cajole and deceive.
The man talked for 4 hours and not even a cup of tea in between.
I mean, he was able to use this combination of charm and obstinacy to get through ideas which others possibly may never have done so. And I mean, the big idea, you know, was this genius of his for reducing design and architecture to its essentials in a way that enabled ordinary people to build for themselves.
Reducing it down so you don't have to have sort of employing loads of sort of quantity surveyors and lots of admin and things like that.
He didn't have consultants. He did it all himself. He made the calculations for the cost. He made the contractual arrangements.
Structural
calculations. Yeah. All himself.
He was one of those persons you call an empowerer. He gives you enough information that he said, look, anybody can build a house. All you need to do is cut a straight line and drill a straight hole.
That was one of Walter's principles, was that people would be enabled to change the interior of the house or the exterior if they want to add a room.
Well, the method was that Walter Segal, that the houses should be built with material that you can get down at your local lumber yard without having to order any special items. Everything should be able to get off the shelf. Like plasterboards come by 2.4 by 1.2 and then you cut it in 600 in modules. So the whole house is the module.
It was entirely designed for laymen. It was necessary for them to jump over normal conventions of producing and drawing plans which require a different degree of knowledge, understanding and so on. It was drawn and conceived so that with no knowledge you could understand how to make plans, provided you accepted always the basic grid. And since all the parts, wall units, window units, doors, partitions, are all on the modular grid, you have got a basic dimension formed by the dimensions of the building materials used. Mass-produced, reasonably readily available materials to be put together in their market sizes.
That's interesting. It's a prefabricated building, but it's not specially prefabricated.
And it makes it easier. So I can go down to the local lumber yard and go and order up a piece of the wood and design it in such a way that I do 600 modules.
One of Walter Segal's ideas was the houses were very modular, that you could move it around as your family and your lifestyle requires.
Because all the internal walls, you can unbolt them and move them, because none of the walls, including the externals, are load-bearing.
People can add rooms, rearrange things, take walls down to make bigger spaces, put walls up to divide spaces up.
This kind of scheme was that you don't have to change the topography of the land. Conventional buildings, you've got to level it and put a concrete slab or dig a pit, make a concrete base. But with these, you don't have to change the land at all. You can put your piles where they're supposed to go, and then you just come along and put your stones on top, you build your frame and raise them up on these slabs.
It's an ingenious kind of invention in a way, conceptually. Yeah.
The nature of this building style, it enables anybody with just reasonable skills can actually build their own house.
And one of the original Lewisham self-builders remarked to me, he said, you know, standing in front of their new house that they just built, you know, if I can do this, I could do anything. I mean, what's going to stop me? There should be more of it, more opportunities. There are elsewhere, you know, I mean, on the continent. Stockholm, they've had a self-build housing department as part of the city council since 1922 or something, I think. The Senate in Berlin's got a little office that promotes it. The banks support it. The banks look at it as the safest investment that is possible. You know, self-builders don't fail, they can't afford to. Completely opposite here.
A lot of people in Britain just think bricks is best and would puzzle about the worthiness of a timber-framed house.
Over there, it's seen as natural, sensible, achieving better standards, lower costs, more satisfied people.
We don't have to leave it to Barretts and the Wimpeys and all the big boys to do it, because they're only building it for profit. They're not building it for communities.
If Walter were alive today, I think he would want to get involved in solving London's housing crisis. He was very much concerned that people would have decent places to live, and I think that was one of his motivations in setting up this project. I think more architects and designers and town planners should come and have a look at Walter's Way and see the Walter Segal buildings. I think they would find it very inspiring.
Architects can design houses for real people, not grand design stuff where you run out of money, you call up daddy and daddy gives you £100,000 backload, you know. That's not the real world.
There are current self-build projects where they are talking to local authorities to try and get social housing built based on this model.
We've done it, and it can be done better. And we hope that the next model will prove that point.
You know, it would be really good if there were more successful projects like this one.
We did have a meeting last year down at the House of the Commons, and one of the MPs stood up and said, yeah, you're talking about 34 houses in Lewisham, but actually we need to talk about hundreds and thousands of this type of schemes up and down the country to really make an impact. So that's the dream.
Guests this evening, and so we actually have three people here who actually met Walter Segal. Is that right? So Pauline Kennedy, you built one of the houses in Segal Close back in sort of the late 70s, early 80s. Jon McKean, you are an architect and architectural historian, and you wrote a biography of Segal called Learning from Segal. And I believe you worked quite closely with Segal on that project and got to know him.
Yeah, the book was written after he died, but I was asked to write a book about him before he died, and
yes.
The publisher went for a Swiss publisher,
yes.
And it went bust. So we then had another go later on. It was actually a publisher who was connected with the Asbestos Cement Review, which was not a very popular notion by the mid-70s. And Walter had been very keen. He had links with these people. He used these glassol sheets in his buildings. But for reasons to do with asbestos, mm-hmm. that particular project died before Walter did. So.
Okay, well, I think, yeah, I'd like to hear more about that. And Jon Broome, you also knew Segal well because you, as you told me, you saw him give lectures when you were studying architecture at the Architectural Association. Then you worked with Segal when you were a young architect working for Lewisham Council, and then were very heavily involved in both Segal Close and Walter's Way as a sort of almost the person who was the architect on the programme when Segal wasn't actually sort of actively there on site himself. Is that fair to say?
Well, there was another aspect to it, which was I actually ended up building one of the houses as well, which was seeing it from the other end, which was quite interesting.
So as well as being an architect, you're also a self-builder and actually lived in Segal Close for, I believe, 10 years. We've also got Kareem Dayes. So you also have quite a connection with Segal in that your parents built a Segal house, and I believe that was just before you were born, is that
mm-hmm.
right?
Yep. And that was your dad?
Yeah.
Yes, in the film. And you've now gone on to set up a new self-build community-led housing project called The Rough, which we'll hear more about. And would you say maybe the self-build element maybe sort of in your blood, in that you were sort of... introduced to the idea at an early age.
Yeah, I guess so. It never seemed to me like this was some kind of alternative weird thing. I thought it was normal that people build their own houses. And then when I got older, I realised it's not normal. Well, in the UK, maybe we'll come to that later. It is normal globally, but in England, it's not normal, I should say. And then in 2008, I helped my dad basically rebuild the house. And I think that experience kind of led me to want to do more. Yeah.
I'd like to also introduce Tom Dyckhoff. I think the first time we saw each other was when you were actually filming in Walter's Way as part of the BBC's Great Interior Design Challenge. But I know that you're also trained as an architect and also an architectural historian, have written extensively about different areas of architecture. Yeah. I'd like to actually just go around everyone and ask sort of, so what does Segal mean to you and self-build?
Well, I first got to know about Segal when I studied architecture in the mid-90s, and that kind of kicked off a complete love affair with, anarchism within politics and also within architecture. I had a great interest in it. And I started to write about Walter Segal in the 90s. And what was fascinating to me was this alternative tradition to architecture and particularly to housing that's not often written about or talked about. And I was very interested in kind of unearthing that. And I've kind of come back to writing about Segal, but also fellow people interested in anarchism, particularly in the 1970s, like Colin Ward. And their interest in how the experience of building architecture, it's not just about bricks and mortar or timber and joints. It's actually about the process and experience of building community, and as a different way. And I'm very fascinated by the sociology of that and the sociology of how you provide housing and how you provide architecture. That's what's sort of most fascinating, I think, about that system. We kind of came up with this amazing, simple system that is so powerful, I think, as well in its repercussions and its potential. I think we're only beginning to see its potential again now.
Brilliant, thank you. I think so. Kareem, as a sort of housing activist, practitioner, someone who's actually set up a housing project, maybe along Segal lines, would you say that's the main sort of thing that you take? Is that something that you took from the Segal self-build homes that you knew about from childhood?
I guess for me it's about kind of social mobility and people having a stake, and this idea of self-build. You're not just giving something, you're buying something, you're actually building it yourself. I know firsthand the opportunity that was given my family. My parents moved out of a council estate, overcrowded, and then moved into this home, had another two kids and extended it, and just had a fantastic experience. So I guess wanting to replicate that and seeing that there's a kind of absence of that kind of scheme since this one and others, especially in London, just trying to fill that space to bring it up to date and meet the challenges of today. Yeah.
Do you think the new project will have some kind of community, Segal kind of community sense? From what I know about the project, it seems like it is likely to be quite a strong community and maybe a...
Yeah, I mean, we're already seeing that with our residents group who have formed, people kind of doing stuff. Some of them are here today. And we're doing a crowdfunder to build like a self-build knowledge hub so we can build like a temporary structure and do training and workshops and kind of spread the ideas. Yeah.
If I can just go on to Pauline. So you actually met, how did you come to meet Segal? What was that like? And what was it like actually, you know, being someone who actually went through the whole project and ended up with a house?
Yeah. I mean, he was just always there. I said we met him when we were building. He was always just popping in, had a cup of tea. One thing that people didn't talk about earlier, that when I was sort of recording conversations with him, was his very grounded, very quick sense of humour. And so for us, Walter Segal was just another person that was an official at that time coming on until we got to know him. So, but he had this great ability to make people feel comfortable and for people to talk to him as well. And I think that was one of his strengths, as well as obviously his knowledge and his approach to life, was why some of the... sorry, I'm told I need a microphone.
Ah.
Okay. Is that better? Yeah? Some of his approach, I think, pulled everybody in, whoever you were, yeah? I think in relation to your original question, what does Segal mean? I think what Segal meant to us, or has meant for us, is a quality of life that we wouldn't have had if we hadn't built our house in Segal Close.
Brilliant, thank you. And I understand that you actually learnt, did he actually teach some of the skills, or were you kind of, did you meet him in the early stages, sort of go to meetings? Were you one of the group that visited his house up in Highgate?
Yeah, we went to his house in Highgate. Teacher skills, he was always teaching us something, yeah. Because people that were on the scheme didn't have building skills, he set up some classes for us with the local
education authority. So people were sent to, you know, learn how to cut a piece of wood straight and how to bolt things together and how to measure things. So that obviously was a good starter to before we started. But, you know, Walter was that sort of person that, you know, if he came on and you said, Walter, I'm a bit worried about, or I can remember ringing him, and people that live in a Segal house will know this. I can remember ringing him one day and saying, Walter, our house was moving last night because in the wind. And he went, oh, you don't have to worry about that. It's fine. It's normal. You'll never have any damage. And we went through the hurricane in 1985, I think it was, and we were the only properties that didn't have damage around us. So he was very approachable, and I think that was one of his strengths, but also I think made us feel that we could achieve what we achieved.
I did hear an anecdote from the hurricane that apparently, it was while Walter's Way was being built, apparently there was a little brick wall that did collapse, but the Segal houses didn't. They
There was chimneys down all around us, but nothing, no damage on the houses.
Thank you. Just coming on to John then, sort of just same question really, you know, what would you say Segal kind of means to you?
Right. Well, he did tell me he couldn't put up a shelf on the wall. I'm interested that he wasn't actually himself teaching you how to drill a hole in a bit of timber. My thoughts were related to what's been said already. I mean, I used to get him, when I taught architecture in London in the 70s, I used to get him to come and talk to my students, which was absolutely appalling. I mean, the students just loved it, but the caretakers had to throw us out of the building after 3 hours. He just wouldn't stop, and it was fantastic. I think probably what, I don't know. I mean, he was my friend. He lived not very far away. He was very, very helpful to me when I was having a difficult time in my private life, which was, he is a very, no holds barred. He'll say what he thinks. I like John on the program, I think, made this comment about the mixture of charm and obstinacy. And I think it was you made that comment, which I think is absolutely right. I mean, I think and it's brilliant skill in life. I mean, I remember him talking about, if he hadn't been paid by the client, he would just go to the site and take the drawings and go home, and the work would stop. I mean, it was very clear. I'm not sure what else I can say, really. I mean, I've lots of interesting memories of being with him. I'm a little worried by Tom talking about anarchy. Maybe I should kind of.
Can I say something about that?
Well,
yes.
I mean, I should probably state a position. I mean, I have, for almost all my life, thought of myself as an anarchist. I have to admit, I did vote in this last election. For the first time in my life, I voted Labour. I had actually voted Green a couple of times before for one particular reason to do with the candidates, but my wife's friend, who was our Green candidate, stood down so that Labour would get in, and so we voted for him, and he did get in. But it took me till I was into my 60s before I would dare kind of believe that, you know, the old anarchist idea that, you know, whoever you vote for, the government still gets in. I've believed that all my life. And Walter did not have that kind of conversation. He was not an anarchist in any political sense. John will probably say something about this. But I have been involved in architecture anarchist groups, both in Italy and in England, for most of my adult life. And at one point, we tried very hard to get an Italian professed anarchist architect, Giancarlo De Carlo, who was also a friend of mine, to meet Walter Segal. Our mutual friend, Colin Ward and myself were friends of both of these people, and Colin and I tried to get them to meet, and we never managed it. And I think that shows they were anarchists. That was all really. But, you know, I would keep it, I don't think it's an issue, really, with regard to Segal. It is with regard to a lot of other people. But that's all.
Sure. Oh, okay. So we've actually got in the audience John Segal. Would you like
to?
Yeah, of course.
I just want to say that the film is wrong because my father did not grow up in a commune.
Yeah.
And Colin Ward wrote an article which has been used many times by others to say that he came from an anarchist background. But it's not true. My father grew up in Ascona, or spent part of his childhood in Ascona, in the Italian part of Switzerland, Lago Maggiore, where lots of artists and intellectuals came to escape the First World War, as did his father, who moved from Berlin. And they lived in Ascona, and they all found life very difficult there, because they'd all come from a city where they could earn a living, and in Ascona they lived a very poor life. But there was a commune on the top, on the collina, on the top of the hill above Ascona, which was set up by the son of a Dutch industrialist in 1900, called Henry Oudenkoven. And that is something separate. And my father's father rented a house on the way up the hill, you know, out just outside Ascona, not in the commune. And of course they knew the people there, as they knew all the artists and writers who had a great influence on my father's childhood, you know. But my father's life and that of his parents was a poor life, actually. He didn't make a lot of money. My grandfather had a terrible hand-to-mouth life, all existence all his life. My father wrote that he trod a narrow line between the bourgeoisie and the Bohème. But my father was a non-joiner. He didn't belong to anything. So to be called, just to be described an anarchist would be a complete anathema to him. Just to like being called, you know, he came actually, my grandparents came from non-religious Jewish origins. But my father said, I'm not a Jew. You know, he was a non-belonger, non-believer. So certainly you can't call him an anarchist. I'm sorry.
It sounds like a purpose.
Yes.
Well, yeah, but the label.
What's fascinating about him is that he emerged, or why he became so successful, was at a time when there were a lot of interesting anarchist ideas, or reception to anarchist ideas particularly within London, but within Britain as a whole in the late 70s and early 80s. That's what's so fascinating is about these ideas then get applied, these ideas about self-provision and self-organisation within a very different kind of climate, where there was a kind of receptiveness, I suppose, to self-organisation as well. So he may not have been an anarchist himself.
But these houses came out of building for private clients. You know, they came out of the little house in the garden, you know, in Nine North Hill, wanting to do more, wanting to build more in that way, finding somehow clients all over Britain, really, who want to do it, some with their own hands, some using subcontractors, you know. And it culminated, really, in people from Lewisham coming to my father, and John was one of them, and saying, you know, can we get a publicly sponsored scheme? Can we get local authority to
But it was always one of Walter's dreams, I think, he had devised this way of building, and he realised very early on the potential for having a simple way of putting bits together that would enable people as a whole, generally, to make places, make homes, make places, and he realised that, and he wanted to get away from the constraints of designing.
But that came. It graduated to that. I mean, the first, you know, because this went on. You have to also understand this is all at the very end of my father's life. You know, there's a whole building career behind, you know, architectural career behind that. And so you see him in the film as really in his last, very last years. And when you say, I just need to say this, when you say that he wasn't, you know, he didn't, when you said he never could put a shelf up. As a younger man, he made furniture himself, you know. So, you know, you're just seeing him at the end. And I do believe at the beginning of the it's also just important to say that the self-builders were all people that were taken off the housing lists. And he had these meetings. You know more about this, didn't you? He had these meetings where people were shown what it was, what it would involve. And then they were asked to come back later, or you know, a number left thought it was going to be too hard, and then out of the core they drew lots. So you know.
But it was his desire to find an opportunity to explore the potential of what he.
Yeah,
it was. Stumbled yeah. On, you
I wonder
know,
if we could just return to maybe some of Segal's sort of early work, sort of up around the time of The Little House in the Garden, because we actually do have a little film of The Little House in the Garden. The Little House in the Garden was a house that Segal built, a small sort of summer house, really, for his family while he was actually rebuilding his main house, which was up in Highgate. We actually have a little film, and it was actually quite well known at the time. The film that we've got is from 1966. I believe, did you know Segal at the point that time while he was doing those early prototypes? It's a bit like you could say maybe a prototype for the Walter's Way and Segal Close houses, in that he was using similar materials, and they were very lightweight. Would you say maybe what?
Well, John's father worked for him.
That's true. I mean, the important thing was this idea of taking stuff that you could get readily available and combining it to make a house. I mean, you lived in it, John. I mean, it was a very basic house. It was, you know, cold and drafty, like Segal houses are.
And noisy.
But nevertheless, astonishing in its economy and speed of construction, and it attracted a great deal of interest because of that, and that led to people commissioning Walter to build houses of that kind.
I think, I mean, you tell me if I'm wrong, but the way that he explained it to us was that he needed somewhere for his family to live while he was renovating his house.
Absolutely.
So he put this thing together and then suddenly realised that actually after a period of time this thing was doing quite well, and actually it could be a prototype for something a bit bigger.
Yes.
Yeah, and I'd just like to say, I think, you know, with your dad, the one thing that I sort of think and I remember is that he was always in Segal Close, and he wasn't just an architect that was doing his, you know, few hours that he was paid to do. He was genuinely interested and genuinely committed to the project, regardless of where it came from sort of early on. I think that was the thing that came over with him.
But isn't it right that there were also classes of how to do
basic
work at the beginning?
Yeah. Do you want to show the film now? Okay, we've got the little film, and then we could go on maybe to the development of the self-build project and how that came about.
This house is a real do-it-yourself effort. It was designed and built at Highgate, London, by architect Walter Segal, for him and his family to live in while their new permanent home was being built at the other end of the garden. Put together like a boy's construction set, the house is made of slabs of compressed wood chips. The slabs, 2 feet wide, are held in position by battens, and the wallpaper is wedged behind them. Sizes of rooms can be altered by moving the partitions. Though planned for temporary use, the house could have a life of about 40 years. It cost less than £900. Set on stilts standing on concrete slabs, the house is kept cool in summer by a lake on the roof. The whole thing can be entirely dismantled in about 10 days.
I was wondering if maybe John and John could pick up sort of how the development from that prototype to the self-build houses that were at Segal Close and Walter's Way. There was obviously a lot of discussion going on, a lot of work to do to get to from that individual house to a council-supported project.
And a lot of time. I mean, as John has said, a lot of other houses
built in Ireland and England, and beginningly, in the beginning, largely built by, what was he called? Ed Wade, was it?
Fred
Wade, right, who had built the little house. And then increasingly, then there was this the wonderful school teacher in Woodbridge, who I've not met for the last 40 years.
Holland,
Mr. So Holland.
These were some private clients.
He's not here, is he? He was the first person to build his own. And he then built a little extension. And I wrote about it in the Architects Journal in 1974 or something, a very long time ago. And he was talking about, in his very schoolmastery way, about how wonderful it was. Nothing like as charmingly as people have been already talking today about the social effects of self-building is building yourself. He was beginning to realize this by surprise almost as he explained it to us. That was really, that got Walter absolutely fascinated. And as John said, there were lots of other attempts. I mean, I was vaguely involved in an attempt in Bromley to get 10 identical two-story buildings built. And I got deeply involved in planning disputes about that because he'd lost two appeals. But everyone else did too. I mean, Ed Cullinan lost an appeal, and I can't remember, lots of then eminent architects were being shoved out of Bromley because they didn't want these modern blocks. But then it moved. Then it moved to Lewisham, and John became involved. And
I understand you were quite instrumental in bringing people together to start the self-built.
Not at all. It's I came on the scene a bit later on because I was working abroad at the time. What was critically important in Lewisham was the combination of having, somebody with an idea, but also having somebody in the amongst the officers in the council to support on a day-to-day basis the grind of pushing this through the process of getting approval, funding,
and
most importantly,
supportive plan committee chairman. Yeah,
and it was the combination of Walter, the politicians who were the chairs of housing and planning at the time. So they weren't just sort of backbenchers; they were the people who clearly mattered. And Brian Richardson, whose name hasn't been mentioned yet, but was an avowed anarchist.
Yes,
but absolutely. Most importantly,
friend of Colin Ward.
Yeah, but most importantly, he was an assistant borough architect. Similarly, in a relatively influential position, and it was the confluence of these strands that managed over about a 3-year period to forge the framework which enabled the first Segal Close scheme to proceed.
And you probably should have named Nicholas Taylor, seeing as you're naming people. Because, I mean, he was the planning chair, yes?
Yeah.
And he wrote this book, The Village and the City.
Had his own views of things.
Yeah, so, I mean, we're in a similar situation, I think. Kareem would agree, with trying to get something off the ground again. And it's been how long? I mean, 9 years, I think, since the idea.
Well, 5 years since you found the site.
Five years since the site was identified. Wow. And, getting the necessary political and financial support behind it is not easy. And we're still not there. At the introduction, I mean, there was this idea of how do you make this happen on a wider scale? And it's at that level. I mean, there's no shortage of ingenuity and energy and all the rest of it. I mean, it's just getting people to believe in this sort of thing. I mean, what strikes me is that we are at a moment with, the Grenfell Tower tragedy, where people are beginning to question the foundations on which, planning and development is being forged. And it's always been my belief that sustainable systems need people to have a active role in what goes on, to have influence over the major decisions that affect what happens. Having a tenants-led organisation in Kensington and Chelsea hasn't done the job. It hasn't cut through And it took somebody with Walter Segal's sort of personality to do that. And okay, he wouldn't call himself an anarchist, but he was a non-joiner, as John has said. He was an outsider. Absolutely. From the establishment view within architectural circles. And that was important, and it was crucially important to success, the fact that he was energetic and
obstinate
enough to push that through. And, you know, without having people thumping the table and saying, you know, this is what should happen, and this is a good way of doing it, and ripping the drawings away when they don't get paid, you know. And I mean, it took a Kenny Atkins as well, who was the chair of the first self-build group, who was a very powerful figure and very energetic. And I mean, it took his energy and again his push, you know, to make this thing happen. And I think it's really important to understand these different strands that all had to come together to make this thing work. And how now, again, you know, to get a project which brings together a lot of strands about people building for themselves, making decisions, and all the rest of it. I mean, to get that to cut through the kind of level control that exists now, it's much more difficult because, you know, the building regulations and all the rest of it and planning conditions and so on are much more complex than they were. Yes.
Tom, you look like you want to say
your... Well, I was trying to make an analogy about what's, in many ways, what's depressing is how uninfluential within this country Segal has become over the last 30 years. And I think that's partly to do with the fact that I've been writing about our idea of the home and housing and so on for a while, and you know, the conclusion you sort of come to is that we've had 30 years where we've been educated to think about housing and homes as a financial investment rather than as a home or as a way of building community or as a way of connecting with your own family but other people. It's principally a financial instrument, and that's been sort of rammed down our throats now for 30 years. So that we come to a situation now that, you know, a very different situation to when these developments were being built. You know, they were being built in a situation where London had lost a quarter of its population since the Second World War. And now we're in a situation where London's, you know, more populous than it's ever been before. Land values are at, you know, are still pretty much sky high in this country. So that idea of the possibility or the freedom to be able to build this kind of development now is so much harder. And that largely comes from how this culture, this shift in culture towards thinking about the home as a financial instrument rather than as a home. That's kind of the real kind of shift in those kind of 30, 35 years.
I think, so Kareem, you're kind of in this, your project is kind of in this at the moment, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, we're in the thick of it now. Yeah, I was just going to say before we come on to that, we always get people visiting our street, like coming down with cameras and having a look and being, oh wow, this is amazing. And everyone here, and I was, oh look up. But the best response I've had, I feel like a German came down our street and there's loads of people there and he just walked down and he just shrugged and was like, you guys think this is really special? Like this is just normal? Like this is what houses are like in Germany? I think that was really the one that really kind of sums up where we are. As in the housing market in the UK, is that this is so unique and special, but you just built some houses, like it's not that big a deal, but the fact that everything else is so bad, this just stands up. And I think that really shows where we are, that it's we're behind, we're seriously behind. Our standards are so much lower across the board, like socially, economically, the build quality, all of it. So yeah, with our project, we're trying to crack that nut, and I guess John kind of alluded to it, like it's really difficult, and right now, on the cusp of getting our planning application in and trying to line up all the money. I think going back to something John mentioned about the finance, like self-build is a bit of a dirty word. All the banks are like, you know, they want a massive contingency in the budget to cover what if the self-builders drop out and all these, and it puts really difficult constraint. It makes it really difficult to do that unless you've got your own money. That's okay. If you're spending your own money, great. But if you're spending someone else's money on this, it's a real uphill struggle to convince them their money's safe. Whereas on the continent, as John kind of said, that is seen as a safe investment, because I think the examples have shown that self-built, people are so passionate about what they're doing, their lives are invested in. Like when my mum and dad built my house, like their whole life was riding on it. They commit everything, and actually the quality goes up, and the chances of them succeeding are minimal, because it can't, because there's just so much riding on it. And actually people go above and beyond to make it the best it can be. And I think a real culture change needs to happen within the kind of institutions that kind of govern house building and the money.
But it goes through at many levels, doesn't it? Because local government is completely transformed since the 70s, when local councils had the ability to take decisions about what they wanted to support. And, you know, Lewisham Council at the time saw this as a way of enabling people to get what they needed and wanted. And it was as simple as that. You know, they were in the business of helping people to achieve what they wanted to do.
But it was also on land they couldn't do much else with.
Yeah, but that's,
so that's positive as well. Why
yeah,
not?
Yeah, but I mean, you know, that was a side issue in the sense that, you know, these days those sites would be developed, you know, no matter what.
Yeah, of course.
But there is a, you know, the politics of it's different, the financial circumstances are different, the organisation of the building regeneration development business is different, and all these things, I think, are coming under scrutiny under the current situation, because they all are part of, you know, the way that the housing business is not working.
But it's all really the wrecking ball effect of Mrs. Thatcher is still rippling through.
Yeah, largely, but there's also the problem, the basic problem is land, and nobody talks about that. Anyway, 1946, it was very nearly nationalised, and Walter Segal was part of a group who were trying to push for that. And Silkin tried to get that into law. Wow, what a different world we'd be in. Anyway, that's all gone long ago.
I'd just like to sort of bring in some the audience. Brilliant. Yeah, it'd be great to get some comments. I can see some familiar faces, people from the self-build community.
So my name's Duncan Roberts. I was a student of Walter's when I was studying architecture. The notion of when things started to go wrong is always, you know, quite an interesting one. And I would go back to the Town and Country Planning Act. You know, it has enormous positive aspects, but it has controlled the supply of residential building land, and when supply and demand are out of kilter, then the price goes up. A statistic that I always love to tell at gatherings like this is that between 1919 and 1939, when all of those stockbroker, Tudor, semi-detached houses were being built, property prices steadily declined because there were more houses being built than there were people who had access to credit to buy them. So actually, the supply and demand was the wrong way around. Town and Country Planning has deftly swapped that around, and we're living with the consequences now. And one of the consequences of that is that I don't live in London, because opportunities are much better and more widely available elsewhere. And I'm working on a project at the moment in Hull, City of Culture, everybody's welcome. Where a piece of land has been acquired at a relatively low cost. We've got financial backing from the Handelsbanken Group, which is a Swedish bank. Yeah. And Caroline here is from the organisation behind the project called Gyroscope. And we'll be getting our five-house self-build scheme on site. Self-build for rent, it should be said. Next spring, which exactly fits into that 3 years development, hopefully 2 years building, that these projects quite often fit into.
Fancy moving, Kareem.
Yeah, well, yeah, I was going to say, yeah, this is the solution to the housing crisis is move.
Move to Hull. Move to Hull.
Move, like, done, yeah.
A question over here.
Hi, Richard Wolfe. I went to a fantastic exhibition at the AA last year, and I'm just wondering where the archive is. the archive of drawings and all the drawings which were shown at the AA. Does that, can anybody help me to know where it is? Does that mean that they're under... Because a lot of the archives and a lot of the drawings that we love to see, and there were some fantastic drawings by you, John, I think they're in pen and ink and rotary. They're safe and sound, yes? Excellent, thanks for that.
It's worth also saying that there's an intent to mount the a different but exhibition, but based on that material in Stuttgart next year.
And Weisenhof?
No.
Is that the university?
Yeah, I'm just interested in any other comments from the audience. I know I can see you're sort of quite far away, and just wondering what sort of brought you to an evening tonight about Walter Segal and self-builder. Are there people here who are wanting to self-build, just interested in Segal sort of history side of things, or I can see one or two people who I know have self-build, like yourselves. Yeah, if there's anything that you'd like to sort of, if you'd like to sort of direct the conversation in any sort of particular direction. Okay.
Hi, my name is Johnny. I'm just curious, has there been a need or a requirement or a desire to update them? I use that term. Loosely, like in terms of a more efficient insulation or something like that. And I suppose the second part of the question is, are they in any way protected against any sort of updating?
Yeah.
Second point first. Walter's Way is listed of local architectural and historic interest.
Really?
Not on the national list, but it's on the local list. And this... and the citation got it all completely wrong, because when you look at Walter's Way, there were 13 identical structural frames constructed. And when you look at it now, I mean, you wouldn't imagine that they even shared a single designer in the first instance. They are unrecognisable. And so the concept of freezing Walter Segal development at a point in time seems to me to be anathema to the intent behind it completely. But that's an aside. I mean, the point about improving the... it has been an ongoing debate for ever since, really, the initial schemes were developed, because it was realised very early on that, in terms of the way energy performance in particular is concerned, Walter's approach to this was, broadly speaking, to put on more clothes if it was cold, which is a perfectly sensible and reasonable approach. But, most of us tend, on the other hand, to sort of, there's an idea that, you should be able to run around in your sort of underwear, really, indoors, and be comfortable so doing. And so there comes a point at which the initial economy and simplicity of the original idea becomes prejudiced by more complex construction. And I don't think the debate really has ever been resolved fully. I mean, there are a lot of other things about, what Pauline's talking about the essence of what Walter was doing and the importance of that, as against, the technical thing. I'm fast coming to the conclusion that what's most important is the framework, the context within which all this takes place, rather than the technical solution.
Yeah.
The technical solution was important because it did enable anybody to build their own place, and Walter realised that, and as we've said, was keen to expand that idea. But until and unless the context with land, money and all these other things and regulation and so on is other than it is now, it's a cultural question rather than a technical one, in my view.
There are quite a few architects.
I was just going to say, we've actually done nothing to ours, other than putting double glazing windows. Yeah, the worst part was the drafty windows of the original buildings. Although I think there's still some original sort of Segal windows in some of the houses, or at least one of the houses in Segal Close. There's never been a need for us to do that because we don't find it cold, we don't find it hot. Some of that I was saying earlier to yourself, when Walter Segal was advising us where to have the rooms, he was saying the sun comes up here, so you should have this room here. The sun goes down there, so you should have this room here. Now, if you move that around, what you'll find is that some rooms will be really hot in the summer, and some rooms will be really cold in the summer. But if you have the rooms in the right place in the house, it's not an issue. Our living room is cool in the summer. And it's warm in the winter because it's where it is. Yeah. So some of that simplicity and the approach of Walter Segal of you know, these are modular, you can put them, get together yourselves, really worked out quite well, and the advice he was giving us worked out quite well. So we've never had a need to go, oh, we're really cold, we need to change something, or we're really warm and we need to change something. However, saying that, there's some people here that have transformed their houses and they're absolutely fantastic. Yeah, but I think, you know, whether that's because they were warm, cold, I think it was just an aspiration. No, it was just an aspiration to do something that they know that they could do with a Walter Segal structure that they possibly couldn't have done with a normal structured house. Yeah? Mm. Is that fair to say?
Sorry. Oh, right. I just wanted to just say something about the structures and how my father went through all this, you know, how it grew. The first house, was it on the film? It's in John McKean's book. It was a little bungalow my father built straight just after he qualified. The first timber-framed house, which was like a great-grandfather of these houses. And the second one, which I spent some of my childhood in, was the ski house, which was a wooden structure, similar kind of roof, but it had wooden cladding, you know. And that house, my father, he did very similar foundations. It was on stilts. In fact, in some part of it was much higher because on a steep slope, and it was quite high off the ground, also because of snow. And my father anchored that. He bolted the posts to the foundations. And he always said he regretted that. He designed the house for 150 mile an hour, whatever, 100 odd mile an hour storms. And it vibrated, because of what you said at the beginning, it used to vibrate. You know, you put your ear on the verticals and they would be singing, actually. You know, and yet never moved. Well, of course, it was anchored. And he said he'd regretted anchoring it. It didn't need to be, even in those kind of gales, didn't need to be like that. But my father was always doodling, drawing, you know, worrying about little things. And you see these changes as, you know, obviously the houses. So the house in the garden was a very basic. John said it was very simple. In many ways, very basic. Right? All these houses were bungalows up to that stage, and Segal Close were bungalows, you know. And then he found how to do this staircase when he started to do these hanging treads, hanging from verticals fixed above, you know. He found out how to do two-story houses. And how to stiffen the frame with St. Andrew, also in one of these pictures, actually, with what he calls St. Andrew's crosses, which he, you know, and I remember the great delight when each of these steps came along. But they are little, my father worried himself about all kinds of little details he'd spend enormous amounts of time doing. The windows he designed, they were, you know, also a sort of detail. Completely usurped or, you know, taken over by double glazing, you know. Kitchens he used to design all the, you know, again, not necessary, people could just buy stuff. And he then had quite a lot of difficulty actually coming to terms with people's individual, you know, I mean, when he was an architect, when he built convention houses before, he was an absolute, you know, a Trojan. He wouldn't allow people to do anything, you know. And the with the self-builders, slowly he kind of gave way. And in a way, what John was talking about the development of you know, the ability that you can and just sort of add on rooms and things, is, you know, kind of follows on from my father's giving away in the small things. So now people, you know, they can do whatever they like. Okay.
Oh, we've got a question from over
Sorry.
Here. In fact, there's a couple of questions. And one over here as well.
Hi, my name's Claire Richards. I'm an architect with a particular interest in how we create successful communities. I have a question about scale. Obviously, Walter's Way and Segal Close are a small number of homes, and you can imagine how people who come together to do that will bond and create a community. What do we think, or what do you think, about the potential for rolling this out in much greater numbers? Are we just looking at multiples in, you know, Hull and other places of small developments, or is there potential for 100 houses at a time, or 150 houses?
Well, thousands in the Netherlands. Only to say, you know, that the important thing to do, I think, is to break it down into small enough groups that are manageable, so that in Berlin, you know, there's, I think it's 10% or thereabouts of new housing is being created by people organising themselves, and they do so in cooperative groups of probably 20, 30 households, something of that order. You know, in the Netherlands, there's a self-built city under construction, and, you know, that ranges in size from groups of around that size down to individual plot holders. And so, you know, I mean, there's no reason you can't upscale this at all, in my view.
There is one in Bicester, isn't there?
Yeah.
The Graven Hill, which is going to be the biggest self-build project.
That's 1,500, I think. Yeah, and that is solely plots for sale, pretty much.
I mean, there was a brief, very, very brief flutter of interest in self-build by the central government maybe 5 or 6 years ago. It kind of came and went in a heartbeat, really. I think the Vista scheme comes out.
I think there are a few. I mean, they tend to be more the sort of the custom build rather than the
pure
self-build.
Originally, there were plans to, you know, there were plans in the Olympic site. I remember
yes.
the original, I don't know what's happened to them. They seem to have come to very little. So.
And there is the self-build register, isn't there? And councils are obliged to help with self-build. So, you know, if you do want to self-build, then it's really important to register that you want to. And then, you know, there are meant to be ways of sort of finding land. And so, Kareem, you found land for your project, didn't you?
Well,
so.
I think mentioning the self-build register is really useful, because I think all these conversations, I think we miss, what's missing most is the people kind of demanding this and like actually saying we want an alternative. And the self-build register is a piece of legislative powers that we have now, where you can register your interest and the local planners have to make provision for land for the self-build. But the problem is not many people are signing up to it. So the government can always turn around and say, well, the demand isn't there for this. So if anyone in here is keen to get involved in this, I would definitely say get on that register as soon as you can. If you just Google self-build register UK, I think it takes 10 minutes to fill it out. Try and get as many people as possible on it, I think. That would definitely help.
Can I just add something to that? My day job for life has been a community worker, and I think some of my aspiration for doing that came from being involved in a Segal build. You know, the strength of what a community can do together. And I suppose I'm echoing what John was saying. I think it can be scaled up, but the one thing that I think you've got to do, and I think Walter recognised this, is you have got to give self-builders some control and some sort of autonomy in the build. Now, if you're just going to say we're going to have this many self-builds and we're going to do it this way, and this is what, you know, this is your the plan of how we have that you're going to do it, and this is what it's going to look like at the end, I don't think you'll get the community. So I think, yes, it can be done, but it has to be done very clearly with giving people some autonomy and some control and some part in the decision-making. And I think probably no bigger than sort of 20 people working together at once.
Can I change the subject a bit? Because I understood, sorry, I don't need that because I'm wearing one. I understood your question not necessarily to be about self-build. Maybe it was, but the question is, how do you make a community? It seemed to be where you were starting from. And I don't think that necessarily needs to be self-build, and if I can be heretical here, I mean, there are other ways of trying to deal with this. Walter Segal, earlier in his life, produced a fascinating theoretical housing layout, which is published in his big book, Home and Environment, which has got a fantastic gradation of scales of community from their terrace houses, which go around. Each house has got a little private garden, which is accessed from, in particular ways, from the two rooms in that house. And that private garden is shared with a shared garden of the 100 houses around a shared green. And then they would share that with the next 100 houses with a more major road and a school next to it. Now, this way of actually thinking that you actually can build a community of maybe 30 houses is a much better group than 100. I have lived for a short while in a Jonutson group of similar houses in Sweden, and the hierarchy of space is very similar to what Segal was doing. My friends in Sweden have a very simple L-shaped patio house, which is what Segal was spent most of his life designing, actually. And then you've got a little patio space, and then you share that. A low wall is shared as group space with 20 other houses. And then there could be another lot. When Utzon was building in Denmark, he built bigger ones where the 20 houses were then grouped with the next 20 houses, and there'd be a lake and so on. I mean, that's nothing to do with self-build, and you can make real communities which actually work because the shared space, you shared children, care, and all sorts of things. It doesn't need to be self-build. I think a town of 10,000 self-builders doesn't make a community. It makes 10,000 self-builders, and how they're going to do it, I don't know. I mean, I would much rather you stick with something, you know, 20 houses, in groups of 20 houses, self-build or otherwise, you'll get a community. One tiny point? I mean, I was talking this weekend to people who live in a North London group built by an architect called Harley Sherlock in the 1950s, as a kind of contemporary, little younger than Segal, but building the same sort of time. And he built a development for 10 houses around a shared garden, no self-build, I've forgotten where it actually is. It's in Highgate, the bottom of Highgate Hill. Well, that's very close to where Segal lived, of course, but it's in that area. And they still share, I mean, 50 years later, they still share the shared garden between these 10 houses, and it's highly desirable, I'm told. And why not do that? I mean, nobody can think of ways of actually being that social these days.
I mean, there's a big, obviously, the span developments were one experiment that, yeah. You know, yeah. Over a number of decades in this country did try and experiment in those ways. I mean, I think the key thing, though, is the word that you said, Pauline, which was about control. About giving the users control, and that control, as you say, John, can come in all different forms. It doesn't have to be control over actually physically making something.
Well, I mean, it gets back to what John said about Grenfell Tower. You know, it's a kind of tenant organisation around that. Ha! Did they? Yes.
Yeah. I mean, it's the ability to cede control to the user, and also one of the great lessons from Walter Segal is education, and the fact that the process of building was an education in itself. It was about learning how to construct our homes. And I think today we're kind of spoon-fed architecture. It's a product, and we're sort of used to it. And I mean, I don't know.
Can I say one thing very, very briefly? I'll just say one thing else. Segal learned this himself when his first house was, apart from the little timber shed he built in Switzerland, the first house he built in Mallorca. When it was finished, they all had a big party. All the builders were there, and they had this amazing party. And he had no idea that builders could be that friendly with architects. Before he did self-build, he talked about the 30 Years' War as his war with contractors. And he had previously had this amazing experience of putting up a house, and everyone came to the party. The people who'd done all the laborers and the people around.
building can be a convivial act. And that was the kind of fundamental line. Sorry, John, you were going to say something.
Well, only very briefly, that the educational lesson, in my mind, from what Walter did was not just about, you know, building. It was about working in a team. It was about how you relate with professionals. And I mean, you know, Walter was a singular professional, but, you know, he wasn't alone. I mean, there were a lot of other professionals who were kind of poking around, you know, who need to be convinced. And how to deal with, you know, the political setup as well. I mean, you know, this had to get through the council, and it's that sort of learning, I think, which is what's very difficult to engineer under current kind of social conditions, that local authorities don't have influence anymore, politicians don't have the same sort of influence anymore. You know, there are other things culturally which seem to be much more important about, you know, money and profit.
Well, the example you cited in the Netherlands at Almere, new town in, I assume it's that one, was it Almere?
Yeah.
You're talking about? Yeah, which is an amazing, it's a new town outside Amsterdam, but there it came about with the political will of the mayor, and it came about by essentially the state underwriting the cost of the land. The land was the state's land. What's fascinating about it is that it offers so many different pathways to potential self-builders, about how self-built you want to be, what kind of style you want it to be in, and in terms of the costs as well, right now to sort of 60,000 euros if you just want to, you know, a very small, humble dwelling that you put up entirely yourself. I mean, it's sort of fascinating. But it only comes about through political will at the top to enable this process to be as easy as possible, because goodness knows it's a difficult job building your own home, you know, and to make it as smooth as possible is the way forward.
But Kareem's right. You need agitation. You need, you know, to under current circumstances to get this happening, I think.
Well, thankfully, it's, you know, housing is once again risen to the top of the political and national agenda, you know, for the, you know, as it should rightly be.
I've got a question. I'm Anastasia Ridgely. I've part two architect, but I'm currently doing up my own Dutch barge with my boyfriend, and we are sort of trying to tackle making decisions on the spot and trying to do everything ourselves, not only because of the cost, well, mainly because of the cost, but also a case of like learning and feeling that sort of self-fulfillment. So that's sort of my background, but I'm also interested in how this openness which you have with the self-build and those community shared spaces, the challenge of trying to, you're questioning about land, well, the openness you have in the greenbelt and how you can, I don't know, understand and challenge the fact of this community self-build, those open shared spaces, why can't that be, you know, shared with the openness in the greenbelt and understanding how that land is, especially where if there's land which is near the railway routes, how they obviously own majority of the land. And it's like trying to tap into, play with words, because I feel like there's a lot of playing with words when you come to planning applications. It's I'm just wondering, has that had any thought yet? Because that's quite a lot of land which, if it's been dealt with, and I find, yes, self-build, by putting the amount of energy you're putting into it, it's not like you would, you know, you're not creating this house to then move on and get a lot of profit. You're most likely to stay and enjoy that house, and so surely greenbelt land, they would want people who would actually respect the land, and if they put their time into it, then of course they would be able to be there for a certain period of time. So it's longevity of, you know, building a family home, and then also you're maintaining the openness, which they're always saying they want to maintain in Greenland, greenbelt land.
But John's right, I think, about, you know, the fact that it's what the political context within which you view land that's the critical thing, you know, and that's a story that goes back to, you know, the end of the war and so on, about who controls it. What you've got to remember is that any
chunk of the green belt, which there's any chance of getting a residential permission for, has got somebody's option on it.
Yeah.
I mean, every single potential development site in the country has got a developer behind it. And that is a fact. And it, I mean, that's the crucial point about access to land, I think. It's only going to come, you know, when local government and national government figure out some way around that.
A couple of questions over there.
Hi, I'm Paul Dworley, an architect. I agree, and I think behind the developers with their options are the banks. And the banks see that if this land is released, if there is a very successful en masse self-build program or alternative program of providing houses, the danger is that their mortgages won't get paid back or the value of houses come down to truly affordable values, which is nothing. The banks are propping this up because they will lose. At the moment, anyone who hasn't got a house or, you know, huge amounts of people, huge amounts of people are losing out. But I think it is the banks are the elephant in the room in this country, and they are... They ensure that this market remains broken, because that's, I think, where they profit.
I mean, I would make one comment, which is that we mustn't forget, I think, that, you know, there is this alternative view of the world, which, you know, Walter embodies, and the way he conducted himself and his professional life and social life and everything else, and that continues, you know. I mean, there is an undercurrent under all of this, which carries on, and it blossoms, and it, you know, it waxes and wanes between the wars with, you know, the whole Plotlands thing, and you know, there it comes and goes, and there's a lively current at the moment, you know, through what Kareem is promoting. The important thing is to get stuff built and on the ground and people in there. As an example that one can point to.
Can I just bring in John Struthers, because I think this is an excellent example. We've got someone who has successfully done a residential self-build project.
Yeah. Hi. I came across Walter Segal in my dissertation as a young lad at school, not knowing many years later that I would actually use the concept for myself. I kind of like met Jon Broome before he met me through his book. I read his book while studying for my dissertation. I convinced my housing association to invest into helping to build 10 family homes for rent, which Jon Broome, I opted for Jon Broome to be the architect, coming off the Walter Segal principle. I actually took my group in the beginning stages to Kareem's father's home, and his dad was nice enough to let us in to his home and explain to us the concept of self-build. My self-build project was for rent, just affordable homes. I was finding that I was being priced out of the market, and in my local area, Wolf Forest, it's about £1,800 or even more to rent a 3-bedroom house, and I just couldn't afford that whatsoever. So I decided to roll my sleeves up and pester my housing association to get a self-build off the ground. It took me 7 years, but at the end of the day, we now live in a beautiful community where all the self-builders went to college together. We decided to help each other in the homes together, and by working together, you kind of like build your community. And now, off the strength of that, I've been living in the house now for 3 years, not wanting to get involved in another self-build project because I was tired. But on the back of that, I've got two other schemes that people have come up to me and said, like, can you show me how to do this? I really want to know how to do this. I think it's absolutely wonderful. So now there's I've got two other projects on the go, 9 homes, and one's for 11 homes, two self-built groups that have been going for just over 2 years. I'm trying to convince my council that it doesn't take 7 years in order to do this. We talk about land, but there is land out there. There's land that big developers don't want to touch that are suitable for self-builders. May it long continue.
Thank you.
Great, yeah.
I think we might be coming towards the end. Let me just do a time check. It's actually got past 8 o'clock, so I don't know. Should we just see if there's any more questions? I was going to maybe wrap up by just sort of seeing if people want to highlight kind of, you know, what you think are the main kind of learning points from Segal, sort of bringing it up to date and sort of looking at the relevance. I think, you know, John's is a brilliant example of a community generated house building project that resulted in some really nice homes.
And that was following this, the Segal principle. Yep.
And the idea also of doing it for rent as well, I think, as someone was mentioning, longevity and the idea that a property or a building is something to live in. It's not just the idea of building something and then selling it. I think this is a great example. I just wondered if anyone has any sort of final comments or. I'm not sure if I think this might be the only microphone that's actually working, so it might be best to do it that way.
Okay, I'm sort of sitting here thinking maybe we need a bit more anarchy. I just think we're at a really interesting time politically as a country. There's lots of changes going on now. Politically, we could go anywhere at this point in time, and I think that it's an absolutely opportunistic time for people to start pushing for self-build. I think that there's a lot of young people in this country that have no hope of getting a house of their own in the future. I think that we should be looking after our young people. We shouldn't be saying to them, you know, you're going to have so much debt but that by the time you get to 60, 65, you're not even going to have a pension, and you're not going to have savings because you're paying through the you know, out every month for your property, you're paying your student debt. So there has to be changes, and I think it's an absolutely crucial time for people to get the movement going again for self-build and for empowering our young people to provide places for themselves. I said to Kareem, Lewisham's getting a new mayor. I don't know who it's going to be, but it could be an opportunistic time to go get in there, yeah? That's probably, I think, my sort of final comment, really. That's a bit political, I know, but I think, you know.
Very good.
I think maybe Kareem might be a good sort of person to sort of to end with, because this is like a sort of a future-facing project, maybe in the it could be Segal's legacy. Do you think, I like the idea of when the project is finished, everyone has a great big party together, the builders and the residents, and maybe that's going to happen at some point with Russ.
Yeah, I think I agree with your comment. I think we are at a really interesting time, and it could go anywhere. And I think the housing kind of shows as a country we're very much either the state or the market. And it's quite, and obviously with Corbyn and May, it's quite like it's either the state's going to pay for it all and do it all, or we have to buy it on the market. And I do think there is a third way, whether you call it anarchy or the civil sector, or people organising. And I think it's about communities getting organised enough to deliver and build assets for the benefit of the community with the control we've talked about. So it's not just built for you and you have no choice in the size or where or who or how much, what it's made from, the layout, I think. And yeah, self-build is a broader, it's not just about building with your hands, it's about self-initiated. So having the idea to say we want housing, we want it here, we want to build it like this, that's part of self-build, even if you don't physically build it yourself. So I think, yeah, we need, as a community, we need to get more organised to demand this, but better options for housing, and this is definitely something which can be part of the mix. And like I said, the self-build register, there's community land trust movement, there's cooperatives, co-housing, all coming together under this community-led housing banner, which kind of includes all of them. And there's going to be a London-wide hub. It's the GLA sponsoring with CDS for 3 years, so
anyone in London who wanted to do this, there's going to be a one-stop shop where you can get that support. And I really recommend just anyone here is interested, get involved. And I think it's about reaching that critical mass of people demanding it, and that's really going to help moving things forwards. Yeah.
Taran, want to say sort of a few final words, I think especially Taran, because your photography has like brought everyone together to create this book, and we've managed to get a group together to discuss Segal self-build, which is quite an unusual thing.
Well, I should congratulate you two for putting the book together. Yeah. It's an amazing book, and if anything is going to change culture in this country, it's about communication and getting the message out there that self-build is a great option. It's one of the key cornerstones, I think, of housing provision in this country. So I think
this is a self-built book.
Yeah, exactly. It's a self-built book, exactly. So I think, I think we should congratulate you two. Yeah.
Well, please put your hands together again for the esteemed, fantastic panelists today. I think they've done a great job. It's really opened a debate on Segal and social housing and self-build, and it's really interesting and great to be part of that. As a photographer, as an architectural photographer, it's on my doorstep. This is like the best thing ever for me. And it's really great that I've had the opportunity to work with Alice as well. She's really become a real sort of specialist in the Segal historically, and she lives it every day as well. So I'm just very proud to have you all here today, and really proud to have put this book together. So here's your opportunity to purchase the book on a £25 instead of £30. And thank you very much, everyone, for coming. We'll have some drinks upstairs,
fantastic.
Right?
We've got some wine upstairs. Just if anyone would like to come and see the Segal houses, we do open house every year. So that's in September. It's always the third week in September. And we always do the Sunday. So it's usually Walter's Way and Segal Close. So do come and join us for that.
Keep the faith going.